Life is sweet. Let it sweep you off your feet.
Hi, it's Allie and Find Your Joy. And we are back for another exciting adventure. And today it is going to be with Dr. Michelle Barr. Michelle is an author, a transformational life coach. She has done counseling and chaplaincy work. And honestly, reading your bio and looking through your website, I got a little bit tired just looking at what you do. Hi, Michelle. Welcome.
Hi, thank you. It's great to be here.
It's awesome to have you. First of all, love the yellow glasses. If you're listening on the podcast and you're not watching the video, she has, you know, me and my glasses, and she has fabulous bright yellow glasses. They're gorgeous. Huh. So here in Texas, Dallas, Texas, I've been there once. I loved it. And I'm guessing it's a hot day today.
It's very hot. My husband told me this morning it's supposed to be the hottest day of the summer. So we stay indoors a lot.
I bet. Oh, my goodness. So where to even start, because there's so many amazing things you do. I guess if we could start a little bit at the beginning, when you were 2 years old, you started your walk doing chaplaincy work and counseling. And how did you get into all that?
Yes, I love what your podcast is about joy, because even when you talk about my glasses, it's little things that add joy, and they bring me joy. And I always teach about adding little things in your life that bring you joy, and then it attracts the big things. And so I really early on was living a life like doing all the things, graduate, go to college, get married, get the job, build the career. But I had very little joy in my life, and I wasn't self-satisfied, and it was taking a toll on my money, my health. You know, that lack of joy permeates out into everything. And early on, I was in a very toxic marriage, and I decided to leave, which left me as a single mother of a two-year-old. And at the same time as things work together for your favor, even when it doesn't seem like it, I moved away from Dallas for a while because my best friend was dying and I wanted to spend that time with him. And during that time, I was up against, here's my whole life. I was 25, getting a divorce, leaving the toxic marriage, facing the death of my best friend. And I had a real spiritual awakening. And I ended up, I was doing volunteer work at the time in hospice. And I ended up going to graduate school and changing my entire career. I used to work in publishing, advertising, marketing. And I was led into that work and I became a therapist. And then I went to seminary and I became a chaplain because I believe there's a spiritual component in every crisis, whether you even believe in God or what you believe about any of that. And I wanted to be able to speak to that. And then I found my way into the coaching world and I got rid of my license because there are a lot of ways to help people that you can't do under insurance and a license. And so this has really evolved. I've had my business now 14 years. It's really just grown and evolved over time. And I just let it become because as I grew and developed. But what you talk about the most, I learned to follow my joy and pleasure instead of being motivated by pain. And this is where my joy and pleasure led me. And I had to learn consciously finding joy. You have to create it and then more comes.
Wow. I love that. And I don't even know where to start. There's so much to unpack from what you just said. That sometimes pain is a great motivator, for sure, that can be the way. I love how you followed where your heart felt to lead you. And then in the midst of all that, it was you started to find these little pieces that started to bring it together. And how joy is joy isn't always this happy, clappy thing. It for me anyways, right? It's just sometimes it's doing the hard thing and then feeling satisfied. Sometimes it's finding a giggle in a very difficult time. Sometimes all these different things. It's amazing how you did that. So when you kind of made the decision that you were going to transition from you know, 9 to 5, as it were, doing counseling and chaplaincy. What motivated you to do that? How did that even happen?
You really hit on it too, because the most important thing is finding those little joys. When I was in a life of a lot of not joy, people, myself included, tend to think, I'll be happy when, I'll be happy when this, and I'll be happy when that. And you're waiting. And what I learned that was the turning point was you have to start by creating it, and then it attracts more. Because I believe I'm very intuitive and sensitive to energy, and emotions are energy in motion, and they create what we want and what we don't want. And I believe joy is the highest energy to manifest in, to create in. And a lot of us are way down here, like, I'll be happy when, and then we can't create any of what we want. So it was following, what do I not love about my life right now? What would I love? What do I want? And there are days, like you said, it's not always where there's big joy there. It's the little things. It's like reading a fiction book, drinking a cup of tea undisturbed, taking myself to a movie. Travel has been a huge one for me. Where do I want to go that brings me joy? And then I'll plan a trip way in advance so I can look forward to it and make time for it. And I just knew that I wanted to help people, and that brought me joy, but I couldn't do it under my current circumstances, limited by that license and insurance and government and all of that. And I worked in nonprofits and hospitals and crisis centers, and I just really followed my calling. There's something for me to do, and I let it open up, and I jumped in, and then I just kept following the breadcrumbs and the joy. And it's entrepreneurship, I say, it is the most intense personal and spiritual growth and development program you could ever enroll in. So it's having that joy and keep following your joy, even when you're like, this is not going to work. How am I going to make the money? How am I going to pay the bills?
Yes, because I'm doing this thing that I'm passionate about, and everyone around me is saying, oh my gosh, thank you for what you're doing. And yet still, how does the money come? And so that's interesting. I have three things going through my mind at once. I guess my first thing is, when you were talking about, I love that you said that part of your joy was planning your trip. I just want to touch on that briefly. My husband and I have taken a few trips that were like our, you know, larger kind of bucket list sort of trips. And we both times we did that, we chose to make planning the trip part of the trip, in that we put the computer, you know, our laptop, and we plugged it into our big screen TV, and we looked at all the different places. We planned everywhere we'd go, and we worked on it for months. But we've taken two, you know, larger trips that, you know, that were kind of our big deal trips to us, and that's how we did it. So I love that you said that, because that you made it part of that to be part of your joy. So but back to the money part. So what are your suggestions to people that are maybe looking at doing what you're doing? Because sometimes money comes in buckets, and sometimes it's so dry that it can feel like, I don't know, am I doing the right thing? Do you have any wisdom around that?
I've really been there. I've had to work through that. I had a lot of money issues when I first started my business, when I left the therapy and all of that work. I didn't make good business decisions. I was just following this heart of wanting to help. And I ran my business into the ground. And then I had to learn about and get right with money. A lot of people who love to help others, we don't value our work. We're not good at charging. We have a lot of issues around that. And that ended up being what I got known for, was helping helpers and healers to create business and create money. Because they're like, I want to help people, but I don't want to make money. Well, then that's not a business. Or they had issues around charging. And I had a lot of them. I believe, just like entrepreneurship is a big teacher, money is a spiritual teacher. And I had to do a lot of work around it. I had coaches helping me with money mindset and with money. And it is a combination of your energy and strategy. And again, the joy of keeping your energy high and not starting to get into your stories. This never works. It can't work for me. I can't have it because there are times it gets tough. So one of the big things that I do as part of my work is money mindset and being able to have true financial freedom. I first wanted to create money freedom, and then recently time freedom, more time freedom. But that money one, it's a big one, and it's tied into your emotions in a big way, your money stories, your money beliefs, all of that. And, you know, money touches everything in your life in every way, and it affects your emotions greatly.
Wow. It's so true. And it's sometimes people simplify it maybe by saying, oh, you know, you can just attract it because you're doing what you love. But like you said, there's a bigger story behind money.
There's a key to that. You do attract it, because I speak a lot about law of attraction, but what people don't understand is the part about taking inspired, aligned action. So you do attract it once you put your desire out into the world. Then the opportunities show up and you have to say yes to them, and they will show up feeling illogical, inconvenient, expensive, scary, impossible. And I have learned you have to keep taking inspired, aligned action, and that's what brings the things in. So you have to do your part, and you always have to do your part first, which is why it's scary, because ask and it is given, but we have free will, and the universe will never impede on your free will. You always have to go first. And so I've learned how to deal with money, create money for what I want and need. It is a key piece, the action, inspired, aligned action.
Wow. I love that. And I love that it for all the different people that, how do I say, I love that you talk about it from the entrepreneurial mindset, because so many times those of us who are whatever, counselors, massage therapists, Reiki, sound and vibrational therapy, art therapy, like all those different complementary therapies that come in the healing realms. I don't know how many people think of themselves as entrepreneurs, understanding that piece of it. I love that you've so clearly drawn that line, that's what this is about. If you're doing it as a business.
I love that you're bringing that up. It's a key thing you hit on, because my first business was a local healing center in the community, and I'm an energy healer. I'm intuitive. And I was doing what people like you're talking about. We learned to sell sessions. And back then you sold it for $1 a minute. And I went broke, and people want to help and heal, and they know they need to sell their services, but they don't think of themselves as business people or entrepreneurs. And all of that about taking love donations and all those things. If you're a business, you're a business. If not, you're a 501c3, but you got to decide what you are. And I had to learn to run a business, because I haven't had a job since 2006, because I only want to do what I'm made to do. But a lot of my clients are therapists, massage therapists, acupuncturists, chiropractors, everything you just mentioned, and intuitives and healers. And I had to get both that business mindset and the energy. And it makes all the difference, because I believe people need those people. We need healers in the world, but they don't know how to take care of themselves. So then they have trouble staying in business. And that's what got my heart.
Oh, I love that. So right now, this is interesting. So I have a lot of listeners who are exactly, that's who they are. And we often have these conversations about, you know, our heart would break for someone. They, you know, that they need the help, but they can't really afford it. And okay, this one thing I'm just going to do. It's always this one thing that I'm going to do. And sometimes that's appropriate. And we have to keep our lights on too.
But money stories, people's money stories are money stories. And I had to learn not to fall into them. And people saying they don't have any money can mean very different things. And it's actually our own wounding that has us fall into other people's money stories. And people who tell you they don't have any money, then you see them on Facebook on a beach Caribbean trip. So we as healers fall into people's money stories, and it is our undoing. And you have to learn to charge. But yeah, I did the same thing. And it's my soapbox now because so many of my clients are in that position. Right. I actually wrote a book a few years ago called From Calling to Cash, because people who need to make money with their calling, and it's how to heal all that, because I had to so that I could stay in business. You're right. We have a business.
Yes.
And
yes,
we have to keep, but it also does not actually serve you or the other people when you give your work away for free. And then you're going to say, but Spirit always sends me people who need my help and don't have the money. No, it's because you've told Spirit you're available to work for free. So you're getting them all, because I don't get them anymore because I'm not available. I can't do it. I'm not available for it. But we're so tied into serving Spirit.
Oh, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. So now you've got, how many books have you written?
I've written 4.
Oh, goodness sakes.
Mindset books, From Calling to Cash was my book that is for the healer who, yes, needs to understand how to heal all that so they can have a business that makes money. I believe healers should be paid well for what they do. And that's the life I've created and live now, but I struggled with it so much.
Wow, that's wonderful. Now you have a new book coming out.
I do. I have a new book coming out October 1st, and it is called Loving What's Next. What you want can be yours now. And what I like about this book, this is my first book that I got a book deal to write it. So I have a publisher now and I got a book deal to write it. And they wanted me to write a book of how I take my clients through the whole process. They wanted exercises, tools, teachings. So that's what this book is. And I really like that it shows you. I've been working with private clients now for 13 years, 14 years. I do a lot of one-to-one. So this is how I take people through that whole process. I have a lot of healers as clients, like I've said, but I have people in every industry who have a heart to serve and then can't make money because they're blocking that.
Right. Oh, that's amazing. You also have a podcast by the same name.
Loving, I do. I've had my podcast a long time. We rebranded it for the book, and the podcast is called Loving What's Next, and you can see it at lovingwhatsnextpodcast.com. And the thing about it is I do series. So I do a whole series on different things like manifesting, creating, having a business, the hero's journey. So it gives you a lot of those teaching and trainings in podcast form.
Oh, I love that. I'm going to definitely check that out. Lovingwhatsnextpodcast.com. Oh, I'm definitely going to be checking that one out.
Right.
So,
yeah.
So what does, typically people contact you, I'm guessing in a virtual world, they don't need to be living in Texas. People are, we're zooming all over the world now.
I do. I have clients all over the world, and I have for a long time because I took my business from that local healing center to an online global business and turned it into a coaching business and then started speaking and teaching. And I have a lot of free resources for people on my website. And then I'm very active on social media, especially Facebook and Instagram. And so people can really find out what I'm about and get those teachings daily to then decide if they want to do anything with me further.
Oh, I love that. So there's already a buffet. People can come and be picking up all kinds of wonderful tidbits along the way. And then if it works for them and they like what they see, they can decide when it works for them. But they have already all these supports that are going on.
Yes, because I'm really, part of my calling is to get the information and inspiration and motivation out to people. And I'm a natural teacher, and that's why I write the books as well. So above all, I've built a community of people like you and me that need and want these teachings and trainings. And I'm always investing in myself where I have coaches and I learn, and then I turn around and share what I've learned.
Oh, that's wonderful. So is there such a thing as a typical client? How does that, like, is it, does a person, when they sign up to work with you, or is it something that happens over a certain amount of weeks, or is it one session, or is it go on for a longer time, or is it dependent on the person and the situation?
Some people have been following me a long time and then hire me, and other people find me and hire me right away. And I work with people usually in a 3-month or a 6-month container where I'm your private coach and you have ongoing access to me. And then we meet regularly. And then I just pull any of what I've done. So a typical client is someone who has a spiritual journey connected to their work in some way, no matter what work they're doing, or they have a spiritual business they're building. But I also get people out in the business world who really have a spiritual seeking or spiritual awakening. But it really is that some part of your work is a calling, and you really want to integrate all those parts of your life. Because I'm a business strategist and I'm an intuitive and an energy worker as well. So I work with my clients strategically, energetically, and intuitively all at the same time. And so in your life, what you want to know is you're always working on both. There were times when I didn't have the strategies to build my business, so I had to get those. I had to pay and hire for those. But there were times I had a coach giving me strategies that my energy and my blocks would not allow, my beliefs would not allow. And so you're always working on the inner and the outer, because you can work hard. You can just work hard and make things happen. But when you really want this life of joy, like you're talking about, you want to love every minute of it. Even when it's hard, you still want to love your whole life. And that makes the best healer anyway. Healers need to be living a very thriving, fulfilled life. That doesn't mean you're perfect. You're always going to have areas in your life you're working on, but you've got to be full of joy or you become this empty well that people are just pulling on. So you really want to attend to the energy. But I will say, especially too, for the people you're talking about that are in your community, there are proven strategies now for healers to make any amount of money you want, from the six-figure solid business just to support yourself and live whatever life you want, to the $1 million and beyond. It's already proven. People have paved the way and it works. You just have to learn how to do it. And it's part of you building that spiritual business.
Oh my gosh. I love it. I love it. It's exciting to me. Well, for myself and for so many people that I know that do amazing, amazing things. And that find out, this is funny. I had no idea that we were going here today. This is such a beautiful bonus for me. I'm going to be going and checking that out. I'm going to be telling so many other people. I can't wait to get on my Facebook and start saying, look what's coming. You're going to see her in about a month or so. And I can't wait to share her with you, because I love what you're saying. I'm thinking of artists, musicians, visual artists, writers, poets, like I'm just, sculptors, my friend has a shop called Bodacious Lifestyles, and it's all beautiful clothes. And it's just, I'm just thinking of every single person that I can think of that does anything, and that it should be in a way that it's a momentum thing, right? It's a momentum. Money comes, money goes. Money comes, money goes. It's this way, and just welcoming it and finding ways. I've just got a few friends right now that I just want to phone and say, hey, check her out. You have to check
I'm
her
so
out.
glad. I mean, you bring up artists and all that too, because I've always been a writer. The starving artist and the starving healer are these stereotypes, and
Yes.
especially in our world today with a global platform. I have clients all over the world I've never met. Plus, because we're the communicators, we're the artists, we want to.
Yes.
You have the perfect platform to do all that and reach a lot of people and impact them, but you've got to make the money because impact costs a lot of money. And running a business, it costs a lot of money. And so part of it is our inner issues around money, but that starving artist and starving healer, they've got to go. Their old paradigm, and they're not true anyway, and they're not
Right.
necessary anymore. I've had clients who are photographers, artists. One of my clients, who's a big artist now, she wasn't doing her art because of her beliefs and her blocks around it. And she
Yes.
was trying to do other work because that would make money. And now she's solely doing her art, but she's doing it in a way that makes money so she can keep doing it. And it's all she does now.
Well, I'm just gonna be really raw and open right here. You are preaching to me. Like, I need this. I will be contacting you because although I will say I was told, a few years ago, just intuitively, just to start following all these things, and that's what I've been doing. And people, me and a whole bunch of other people just like me, are still the missing link is the financial part. And
It is so
I'm excited.
doable because
Yes,
I'm so
doable.
passionate about the healers, the intuitives, the creatives, all out there in the world serving as they're called to do. I show them how to make that profitable and sustainable. And it's so doable. And you have to start with clearing that and deciding that you're committed to that and figure out whatever's in the way because it's serving you in some way. It was serving me in some way to be a healer and not have enough money.
Right.
And so it's working through all of that. It really is. It's mindset. And then when you do it in one area of your life, you can do it in every area of your life because I believe, especially when you're doing spirit's work, why would spirit not want you to have the life of your dreams? And once I realize that, and then there's one saying that applies here that I always say, if you take nothing else, that when I first heard it, I didn't believe it. And now I do. And that is the highest good of all has to include you, or it's not the highest good. And that
Oh,
changed my whole life.
the highest good of all has to include you, or
Or it's not the highest good.
I'm writing that down.
Yes, that is one. When my coach first said it, I felt and noticed it was like, wait, no. And now I realize it's absolutely true.
Yeah, I love that. And everything that you're talking about is very much the path that I've been walking down and feeling drawn to, and sort of just everything. My husband and I, Dave and I, just everything has been, we've kind of abandoned all else. And we're just following that thing, going, we don't even know why how this is, it doesn't look like how we think it's supposed to look yet. Just going to keep doing it.
Then you're on the right path. That's how it looks when you're creating with yourself and your energy and
Yeah.
spirit and that universal flow. And you've got a big piece of it because you're focused on joy. The more you can stay in joy, the easier and quicker it is to manifest. So I've learned that too. And you're right. I could not have told you this is what my business and life would look like today at all. This was
Yes.
not in my plan, and it's taken so many different directions, and I keep following, and now a new direction. It's that loving what's next, and it's better than I could have ever created it. But you have to learn your part. Some people think, well, if it's all spirit and energy, I'll just sit here. You have to do your part, and then the
Yes.
universe rushes in to meet you.
Yeah. Oh, that's beautiful. I love that. Oh my gosh. Wow, Michelle, you've left us with a lot to chew on here today. This is just amazing. So your new book, Loving What's Next, is coming out October.
October 1st, and it's on Amazon right now. If you go to lovingwhatsnextbook.com, you can find it on Amazon for pre-order, but it'll be out October 1st.
That's awesome. And Loving What's Next, the podcast. So everyone listening, check out your website. Will be in our show notes, so they can find you there. You've got a podcast, you've got your books, calling all healers, entrepreneurs, artists of all type, business people, basically anybody living on the planet. Look her up. I don't even like this saying, but I'm just going to say Michelle's the real deal. I'm excited. And, you know, we'll tune back in a year and see how I'm doing then, and we'll know for sure. But yes. Thank you. Thank you so much. I so appreciate you taking the time to come and just share this really important message. I love it. I feel really inspired.
Thank you for having me. I can talk about this stuff all the time, and I loved our conversation. And like you said, it just goes where it needs to go for today.
Yeah, that's beautiful. Well, thanks so much, Michelle. And to our listeners, thank you so much for coming and hanging out with us today. Don't forget to like and subscribe. And as always, find your joy.
Thanks so much for joining me today. If you found a piece of your joy in this episode, I would love to hear about what came up for you so that we can continue to grow the impact of this show. Thanks again. See you soon. And remember, find your joy.